Judy still has it.
I think I only know some.
Yeah, not this guy.
Alright guys, it is currently 12:11, so I'm gonna go ahead and get started. Thank you. Alright, so my name is Judy and I'm the vice president of PYP Kiwanis. So I know what you guys are all here for. You're here to listen to Murray talk about cryptocurrencies. But before we do that, I just kind of want to jump into the other things we're going to talk about today. So at the very beginning, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about PYP Kiwanis and what we do. And then the cryptocurrency seminar, it's going to take up a majority of the meeting today. And then after that, just a few quick updates about upcoming events that we have. And then afterwards, this is completely optional. You don't have to hang out with us, but we are doing lunch. We usually grab lunch after. And we're going to Carol of Lights in downtown Campbell. All right. So let me quickly introduce who our board members are. Rachel, if you want to stand up.
Okay. Hi, I'm Rachel.
Yeah, so she's our president.
And this is Andrew.
Mm-hmm. Hi.
Trump's not here yet. He says he'll be here.
Oh,
and I'm Judy. I'm the vice president. So if you have any questions about our club, by any means, you know, come up to us, talk to us. We don't fight. We're pretty friendly, and we'll go on and on about Kiwanis too. So whatever questions you have. So yeah, let's talk a little bit about what PYP Kiwanis actually is. And to get into that, let's talk about Kiwanis. So Kiwanis was founded in 1917, and we have about 600,000 members worldwide. So over 80 countries, and over the course of the year, we'll do about 150,000 service projects. For those of you who are familiar with Key Club in high school or Circle K in college, we are actually their parent organization. Oh, come on in here. And so the club is mostly dedicated to serving the community, specifically for the youth and for children. And so what makes PYP a little different? For those of you who are familiar with Kiwanis, you'll know that they're like San Jose Kiwanis, Campbell Kiwanis, they're location-based. But us, we're a little different. We are dedicated to young professionals. So we really work our club around young professionals' lifestyle. So, we work around your work schedule, we work around your budget, we keep our fees very low, and we try to keep things really tech-heavy. Like, for instance, right now, this seminar is being broadcasted on Facebook Live for our members who are going to make it out today. And then, when we're collecting dues, we're like, yeah, guys, just demo us. It's really easy. Report our hour online. So we try to keep everything just really streamlined that way. And then one of the other perks is, it's a really great networking opportunity to be part of PYP. As you're getting established in your career, you're gonna notice you're seeing a lot of the same people. So like engineers are gonna meet more engineers, designers are gonna meet more designers. But if you come to PYP, we're actually a fairly diverse group when it comes to like ethnicity, culture, working with different fields. So if you're really looking to expand your social circle, your friends, this is the place to be. But if you're looking to network professionally too, it's really awesome because, as I mentioned before, with Kiwanis, they are location-based, and the reason we started this young professionals version is because they generally are an older crowd, so we don't quite fit in with them. But we still do a lot of projects. We still do a lot of projects together with them, and we're really close with the other Kiwanis clubs. And so if you are looking to meet someone who is established in your field, someone who can connect you with the right people, mentor you a little bit, this is also a good place to be. So whether you're looking to make friends, whether you're looking to become, just more professional career-wise, we can help you with that. And some of the perks that we provide to our members is sometimes we'll do photo shoots, we'll do these seminars, we'll give you business cards, anything you need to help build your career. So when we're saying we're helping the community, that doesn't mean it's like other people. We want to help each other too. We want to make you be your best. But that being said, we are definitely helping the community. We do a lot of hands-on community service work. We mentor a lot of children. So like I said, we work a lot with Key Club, Circle K. We're just doing our best to help out there. And if at any point you guys have any questions about it, just raise your hand. So you might also be wondering, like, why do we have these seminars? Then, like, why are you here? I don't
I'm just trying to get the word out there that we exist. So if you do know people who like to do volunteer work, please send them our way. But the idea is these seminars are open to the general public, and so you can invite anybody. And our speakers are generally just our PYP members who are passionate about a very specific topic, and they're trying to give back to the community by spreading knowledge. And so our past topics, we just started this recently, we've done like optimizing your job search, how to buy a home as a young professional with no real estate experience. So again, we're catering these topics to our members. So if you guys have any requests, just let me know. I will find someone to talk about it, or I will talk about it myself. So yeah, just let me know. And if you do want to reach out to us, this is our contact information. It's also on your printed agendas in front of you. Yeah, so you can email us, we're on Facebook, Instagram. If you want to just give us money, we have Venmo. Yeah, and you can also just contact me anytime at this phone number. And then on the back, what was that?
No.
And then on the back of your agenda, there's actually a note section too, so Murray's going to come up and speak pretty soon. So if you want to take any notes, you can see the back. Alright, so that was my little spiel about our club. We're going to start doing what you all came here for. So Murray Nguyen, he is going to be our cryptocurrency expert today.
Expert. Yeah. Not a professional investment expert, but yeah. This is a broad overview of cryptocurrency in general, so I kind of just want you guys to know like what these words mean and what's been going on and what the buzz is about, right? So to get with a grain of salt, my investment strategy might be what you want to do for your investment strategy. So let's switch to slides. So again, my name is Murray. I started investing in cryptocurrency for about a year now. Started with an app called Lawnmower. It's like one of those apps where you you send a transaction with your credit card to when you're buying stuff outside, and it will increase that to the next dollar and take that change and invest it in something. Like a lot of them are used for retirement funds and stuff like that, but this one itself was used for cryptocurrency in Bitcoin in general. So by the end of like 8 months or so, I'd amassed like $800. And that grew to $1,000, and I was like, "Whoa, I really think I might want to look more into this, right?"
What's it called?
It's called Lawnmower. It's actually shut down now.
Oh.
Yeah. So you won't be able to find it, but I think it's because there's just more regulations that are coming through, and that just took them off of it. So. Also, I'm a pretty big risk taker. When I do my investment portfolios for 401k and Roth and stuff, I set it to like the full 10. So that'll be from this perspective, so that you guys understand. And cool. Not a professional investor again. Cool. So let's start with a tool that I learned about is called Slido. You guys can take out your phones and connect to the Wi-Fi network and to this website called slido.com. We can do like a little interactive question and a poll that we have in there. That right now. It'll just keep it like a more interactive presentation and just make sure like we all remember what's going on. And if you have questions throughout the presentation, instead of raising your hands, if you didn't want to, you can put questions in there, right? Because that kind of turns off doing questions sometimes.
So what happens to your funds if the website shuts down?
So that website, before they shut down, they'll tell you. They'll send you like an email. They'll send you a letter. They'll be like, "Hey, we're shutting down. You might want to transfer your funds," just like with any other website, right?
If you don't,
then
you lose it.
Yeah, they might hold it. You know, sometimes it's not governmental, so I don't know if it's part of it. But you can go on a website where if government owes you anything, then you can search your name and stuff. Cool, so you see a poll on there right now. If you can answer that question, it should be, how did you first hear about cryptocurrency? So I kind of want to understand where you guys are coming from first, before we start my first question. Andrew, Tom, you have an interesting face on.
How did you hear about Slido? This is interesting.
I actually went to a product school talk about Bitcoin about a month ago. It was a Google product manager that was giving the presentation, and they had this Slido up. So I was like, wow, that's pretty cool. It keeps it pretty interactive. People who are kind of afraid to ask questions, I'm sometimes afraid to ask questions. So I put my question on there. You can remain anonymous on there if you'd like, or you can put your name down. right, Mr. Robot Show. Murray Nguyen, that's me.
Awesome.
Video games? What? There's video games with Bitcoin in them though?
They do marketplaces where they exchange. Like,
oh, I see. You mean like fake trading, right?
Well, they use real.
They use real Bitcoin to exchange like items in the game.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Okay. So instead of using cash, you're using Bitcoin to buy stuff, didn't you? Okay. College friends in 2011. Cool. So like, did they really like Bitcoin? You're like, they're like, hey man, you should really get into this. And you're like, what are you talking about? You're crazy.
Yeah.
The earth is totally flat, man. Not round. Hi mom. Am I in the right class? I hope you guys are here for cryptocurrency. If you're not, it's like 50 minutes long. You should get out now. Reddit, cool. Yeah, Reddit's one of the places I get my sources to. Reddit's a place where you kind of have to take it with a grain of salt because you don't really know who's posting, right? Anyone's allowed to post, even if they're right or wrong. The Reddit subreddit would be... That's you, Dewey, isn't it?
No.
Okay, news, cool, never heard, Mr. Robot. First heard about cryptocurrency through the media, now I'm doing my own research. Cool, glad you're here doing your research. Bitcoin, heard news about Bitcoins from years ago. The words of mouth, and this one. Bitcoin mentioned form of currency with dealers for drugs for anonymous. Okay, so that one, that was the Silk Road being used, Bitcoin being used for drug interactions. It was like a website you had to go through Tor and like kind of encrypt yourself before you can buy drugs online and they'll ship it to your house, right? So a lot of misconception there with like Bitcoin only being used for drugs. It's kind of like cash. You can use your cash for drugs too, but you can use your cash for multiple different other things as well, right? So don't like just associate Bitcoin with drugs. That's a big misconception, and I think you can see that now in the trend that everyone's adopting. They can see that the technology is a lot more broader. Cool. Let's see if there's any more. If not, we can. Cool. So last one. That Murray is pretty Slido. I like that.
That was not. All
right. Now that we kind of know where you guys are from on cryptocurrency, we can go into what I'm. So first, I want to start with some rules of investing I have. First, you should really start budgeting, because you guys are all here to invest in cryptocurrency, right? So budget. Make sure you take care of yourself first, what you're comfortable with, what your lifestyle is like. If you want to buy that house, you should put money aside for that house first rather than crypto. But you could be more risky. You're like, man, what if that crypto goes from 11K to 100K? I could buy the house faster, right? So depending on your risk level, take it. Make sure you budget first, though. A little retirement wrapper that I kind of follow is emergency fund first, 3 to 6 months. Why do you guys think it's 3 to 6 months?
If you lose your job, you have 3 to 6 months to get a new one.
Yeah, your house catches fire, you probably have 3 to 6 months, which is a good amount of time to like end money to get yourself back on your feet, right? Mm-hmm. Next is your company 401k match. So if your company matches your 401k at all, I would suggest doing your 401k first, just so you get that match. So if it's like matched up to 6%, you put 6%, they give you 6%, that's 12%. It's good to go. And Roth versus 401k, you actually get taxed differently. And so your Roth, you get taxed upfront, so all your gains are not taxed. So that's why after you get out of debt, then you go to Roth, then you come back to your 401k and finish it off if you want to invest more money there. And I would say, this is where the tier for cryptocurrency should be, in my eyes, right? After you've taken care of yourself for the future, at least. Rule number two, pretend that you've already lost that money. So you don't really want to be using, again, you want a budget, you don't want to be using money that you're like, I need to eat next month, but I really want to go get crypto, right? Then next month comes and you're like, shoot, I want to eat. But crypto just jumped from 11K down to 8K. I'm gonna take it out. You just guaranteed your loss, right? So that's not something you wanna do. You wanna put in money that you can see lose money, but you can kind of stay in there long enough in the long term that it regains back the traction. I think of it more like stocks. If you look at the stock market before, just like this, there's always a crash, but it always gains itself back up, right? And rule number three, think long term. My example for this is Warren Buffett's $1 million bet, where he says, hey, I don't think you guys are good at short-term investing, right? Active investing. So he takes on five different hedge funds, and he says, this S&P 500 will be better than your hedge funds for sure, even though it's not actively being traded. And so after 10 years, whoever has the more gains gets that $1 million, right? And Warren Buffett's going to win the bet, I would say, I don't know. It was done 2 years ago. But it's just to show that active trading is not very important. One of these five actually did pretty okay. So if you want to actively trade your coins, I would suggest against it. But if you think you can do it.
But by actively trading, does that mean like you're constantly like just buying and selling?
Day trading. Yep. I mean, if you want to learn like what a cup and handle is, if you map these and all your candlesticks and stuff like that, if you go into that detail, we could talk about that in a more advanced seminar later, but that's not what this will be about today. More in overview today. Cool, let's get to cryptocurrency then. What are cryptocurrencies? So they're digital currencies that are traded online and backed by speculation. So unlike fiat, which is your USD, your Japanese yen, your UK pounds, it's not something physical that's backed by gold. It's backed by speculation, by like technology that you kind of believe in, and they write these white papers, which kind of tell you how the roadmap's gonna be, how their coins will be distributed, who's running this, and why you should believe in them. So if you believe in like their technology, for instance, one is called Sia Coin, which will allow you to rent out your excess hard drive space for money. For instance, you have 200 gigs of videos on your hard drive, but you have one terabyte hard drive, you have 800 gigabytes left. You could rent that out and make money off of that, right? Digital currency will allow you to make coins from there, and you can trade it for other coins. For instance, let's say Steam Coin is another one that's used for social media, where you can use to like pay people for the content that they give. And so you're using one currency to another, or you can take it out as fiat and use it physically. So a way to earn digitally. A bit on the Bitcoin roller coaster so far from 2009 and 2016. What happened back in 2008, guys?
The crash.
Why did the crash happen?
Mortgage.
Why? What about the mortgage?
Over speculation.
More like subprime loans, yeah. Right? So subprime loans, meaning that these loan agents knew that these guys wouldn't be able to pay it back, but they still paid off the loans. So you trusted these guys, these banks, and we ended up having to bail them out, right? And so Satoshi Nakamura, the guy that actually first wrote up the white paper for Bitcoin, was saying, hey, the system's kind of flawed. We have to trust these guys, and sometimes they're kind of shady, right? And so let's build a system where we don't have to trust anymore. And so that's how. A little bit of roller coasters and kind of like what causes things to kind of increase or not. WikiLeaks accepts Bitcoin donations. First halving. So in Bitcoin in general, and any coin, before you invest, you want to look at their white paper and see if there are like certain rules and regulations they have. For instance, for Bitcoin, they say once you hit a certain amount of blocks, we're going to have whatever rewards you get. So the term we should bring up now is blockchain. What is a blockchain, right? It's a chain of blocks where each block holds the transactions that have happened so far, and it builds the path for the next chain, the block in the chain, right? And a person like Daniel, Daniel would use his computer with his CPU and his graphics card to help mine these coins using his electricity and like his money to buy these like cool, really high-tech specs, right? And that'll help find the encryption key for these blocks so that you can put these transactions in there. And once you're able to mine a block, you get a reward for it. This first halving event went from 50 bitcoins that you would get to 25 bitcoins. And now I actually have again to 12.5 bitcoins. Because as you go on, you don't want that inflation, right? So that helps with the inflation of your cryptocurrency. Cyprus bail-in. Cyprus government had some problems with their bank as well, where they said, hey, citizens, We're actually just going to give you your 100K that you have in the bank. But what else, whatever else you have above 100K, we're actually only give you a spending power of half for it. So they're like, what the hell? You know, yeah, the banks are in charge, so you can't really say anything against that, right? So what people started to do was find an alternative way to where to put their money. And what they did is they put it into Bitcoin. So that's what you see that spike. Ross Albright arrested for Silk Road. Again, that was that drug online website, kind of like eBay, that's what I've been told, is was used for buying drugs, right? U.S. Senate hearing on Bitcoin. From the articles, it was a pretty positive look from the U.S. Senate, but then there wasn't really much that came out of it other than now the government kind of knows about it. There's no really any taxation regulations yet, but the experts say, hey, you should really look at it in like the ultimate form, which is like, if you look at it like a property, you're being taxed at that bracket, which is you'll be safe if you were to just follow that guideline, rather than something that was on the lower standard. Mt. Gox was a exchange, kind of like Coinbase, but more for like other coins as well. And I think it was like 80% of Bitcoin was being traded on there. But the CEO was actually, I don't know if he's been indicted yet, but they found like transactions where he took like money out of there. So one thing we'll come up about later is how to keep your coins safe. And sometimes keeping your coins on the exchange may not be very safe. And if you go to the forums and stuff, they always talk about that. Like, hey, how are you keeping your coins safe? Are you keeping it in a personal wallet or are you keeping it on the exchange? And personally, keeping on the exchange is kind of scary, especially because of this Mt. Gox situation. And then they filed for bankruptcy after because they were stealing money out of the government. Okay, so when you're looking at which coins to buy, there are two different types of coins. Some even have them together. There's proof of work, where you actually do the work, like Daniel here, where you have your graphics card and your processor using the power of your computer to mine and find the encryption for a block so you can put those transaction histories in there, right? And path the way for the next block in the blockchain. Or you can have proof of stake where you put in enough money to show that the community that, hey, I have put in 100K here. I actually believe in this technology. You should trust me with a key to a block so that I can put the transactions in there. So those are the differences between those two. Cool. So that's cryptocurrency in general for me, which is imagining a world where you can earn digitally and spend it digitally, or trade it out and spend physically, right? So that situation again where Sia Coin, renting out your hard drive space to make Sia Coins there, use that coin to either buy storage for yourself in the future when you need, or trade it for something else, that another digital coin, or cash it out and use it for something in real life, like roses for your girl or something. So this was our previous system. This is where we're trying to move to, is the decentralized system. Your centralized system is where you have pretty much one ledger that's controlled by the bank, right? So you kind of have to trust them and kind of give them permission to take care of your money. Whereas in the blockchain, you have a distributed ledger, a decentralized system where many people are mining this block and everyone has a copy of this ledger. So it's harder to manipulate because you have so many copies that you can self-check each other at the same time. So that's the system where we kind of want to go to, and that's what cryptocurrency is mostly about. Another journey of Bitcoin from 2017, actually just this year. A few things to look on this slide, it's pretty dense, but we can kind of break it up. For these lines, that's how long it takes to go from the 1,000 to 2,000 and then on to the next 1,000, right? So how many days it took, and which certain events that came about that kind of paved the way for that increase. And also we'll be going into what ICOs are later, initial coin offerings, and how much was funded for those types of projects. So China cracks down on Bitcoin. If you remember back on the previous slide of the Bitcoin from 2009-2013, China likes to do this thing where they put out fake news to see how people react. And so I guess they like what they had, because they actually did end up banning Bitcoin so that they can, or Bitcoin and cryptocurrencies in general, especially ICOs, so they can start the regulation. So two ways of thinking about this. If you're a government, it's easier to regulate something if nobody's actually using it right now, right? So they ban it, and then they regulate, and then they'll re-allow is what the news is right now. Number of GitHub projects related to Bitcoin passes 10,000. So do you guys know what GitHub is?
I don't.
No.
You don't? Does anyone know what GitHub is?
It's like a code, like you can code and make your own projects. Right?
Yeah, so like it's an easy place for you to collaborate with others. You can both, like all your friends can kind of code online at the same time, and then you have a main branch, and you have splits that you guys can all work at, and then you can branch that into your main branch later on. So a lot of our engineers and a lot of our data scientists are actually using this as their projects and making projects built on blockchain, so that's something to think about. Like, it's actually important to some people. Andrew Tom, data scientist. Bitcoin forks. So what is a fork? You might have heard that a few times. So Bitcoin and cryptocurrency in general are a community, especially the community that mines, the miners. They have the ability to make books. So if you were to mine as well, you would have to download the proper execution files and start to mine yourself, and you would be able to like delegate certain votes with your coins. Like you just spend like one Ethereum to put in this vote because you want it to go in this certain direction or not, right? And so Bitcoin was split between Bitcoin and Bitcoin Cash because they didn't want to follow a certain technology. Half like the group wanted to go this way, half the group wanted to go that way. So forks are those, but all you really need to take out of this is like there are two different ones. So when you search, do a Google search to see what the difference between the two is and see which one you more align with, and then that's the one you most likely want to invest in. Well, Jamie Dimon, CEO, calls it a fraud. There's always going to be someone saying some good things, some bad things, depending on the person. Right. We'll get into that a little bit more after. Wanted to go into a technology adoption curve, just to let you guys know where I think we're at. I really think we are like right here, really close to early majority and a little bit almost after the early adopters, right? So where the innovators are like people like Satoshi Nakamura who were like, hey, this banking system isn't working. Let me see if I can come up with something. So he writes the first white paper. And data scientists and other people, even in other professions, want to like give their input, right? And that's why you see a lot of disruption in other industries, like computing, in banking, in all those types of things. We'll have a list later on. And early adopter, why I think we're here right now is because now you're starting to see it on the news, right? You're starting to see, oh, Bitcoin's jumping up to 11K, but why? They haven't gotten to why yet. People are still just like, oh, this is something, but they're not going into too much detail. Like, we have a seminar today, but we have well, like 25 people, when I think like there should be at least like 1,000, 2,000 people here learning about what this stuff is. And so I think at that point, when we have the next advanced seminars and we see like 2,000 people here, then we'll probably be in the early majority stage. So main question I get from people is, do you think it's still gonna grow? Because it's 11K. What do you think? Again, this is a seminar on cryptocurrencies in general. Bitcoin, my guess at the like middle of the year was it'll at least hit 10K by the end of the year. It's at 11K now. But I think you should also be looking at other coins like Ethereum, Litecoin, IOTA, other coins that are out there as well, because it's from an investment perspective, it's easier to double your money if it's not 11K.
Yeah.
What do you mean by like 8K, 11K? Like what is that?
It's $11,000 right now for one coin.
Oh, $11,000 for one coin.
Yep.
Okay, got it. So when you're buying it, you're like buying a piece of a coin?
You could buy fractions of it as well. Yeah. But you don't have to buy like stocks. Usually you have to buy a whole one unless you're on stock trade. I think stock trade allows you to buy a fractional.
Mm-hmm.
But $11,000 is the price for. So like, Ethereum is like $500, so it's easier to double the money there, right? And Ethereum is kind of the next closest contender with Bitcoin, where they allow if-then statements, or it's programmable contracts. So it'll be like, if Anthony goes to the seminar, then he will get $50 or whatever, right? So once those parameters fit and they're checked, then you can get your coins. as the post intended to Bitcoin next. A lot of people say it's a bubble. So I think that's a concern you might want to have as an investor, because you'll be hearing that quite often. This is a bit old. I think it's about 2 or 3 months slide, but this was the best infographic I could find. It says cryptocurrency in all in general is 100 billion, but I think it's closer to like 500 billion right now. So it has already surpassed Amazon. So this slide is to help you determine for yourself if it's a bubble. A bubble is when, like a helium balloon, right? You don't think that balloon can hold enough, that helium that you're putting in there. So that amount of money, you believe in its potential to hold all that money. From my perspective, I think it can really surpass USD in circulation, because that'll help it be used a lot easier. We don't have to rely on banks anymore. I think it can surpass physical money, even stock markets. People are already using this as an investment tool. They write these white papers saying, hey, this is what we're thinking. These are the people on my team. This is the experience I have, and these are our roadmap. If you believe in us, give us the money, gather some of our coins, and we'll take that money to build what we think will be the best for the future. So I really do think we can surpass it. I don't think the bubble will pop anywhere between here, but up to you on what you think on that. A few bad quotes and good quotes. If you can kind of tell the difference between the bad quotes and good quotes, Microsoft, Google, PayPal versus Chase, Vanguard, Goldman Sachs, what do you see the difference there? Right, the old system versus the new system, the innovators versus those who want to stay with the old system. Even though it's kind of weird, because Jamie Dimon, even though he's CEO of Chase, Intel is a big part of the Ethereum Alliance, which is an alliance that says, hey, we want to build our technology on this programmable contracts, and we're all in on helping you guys make this happen, right? But Jamie Dimon, even other business partners and executives are like, dude, shut up. So, that's the way that people kind of think about it. What is an ICO? So, who knows what an IPO is for stocks?
Initial public offering.
Initial public offering. So when a company wants more funds, they want to go from being private to public, they give the public an offering to give us some capital so that we can build more. If you believe in us, give us some capital. ICO, same thing. Initial coin offering, give us some money. If you believe in our tech, let us grow more. We fund it. Cool. These, again, we said all the categories. These are just 2017 ICOs that were funded over almost $600 million. I believe it's $1 billion about now from the previous recent stats. So disruption in media and social, gaming and gambling, Internet of Things, finance, the cloud, and core tech in general, AI, machine learning. So how do you tell if a coin is good? Read its white paper. Who is starting this? Who is on the team? Let's check out their LinkedIn. Is it someone that's been in the industry for a while? Like, let's say they're making a coin for real estate. You trust someone that's only been in there for 1 year? You trust someone that's actually been in there for the last 20 years? So things to kind of help you gauge your risk, right? What is the technology like? How will coins be dispersed? And the roadmaps. Roadmaps are like, what have they completed so far? And what do they plan to complete and by what time? We'll take, for example, who is starting this? We're talking about now the Brave browser, which is made by former CEO of Mozilla, Brendan Eich, right? So he's like, hey, I helped build Mozilla. I want to go build Brave. Why? Because I believe people don't want to see these ads. They don't want their data to be used for these things. They want to opt out of having to look at ads and having to be tracked. And so Brave browser allows you not to be tracked. And what is the technology like? It's just that. You don't have to be tracked, and you don't have any ads. You can download it on your laptop if you need it, and you can actually opt in and say, hey, I actually want ads, but when I opt in, I'll look at these ads, but you have to give me coins in exchange. So you'll get basic attention coins, BATs. So that's an easy way to get some coins, right? Again, like see a coin, but instead now you're selling your attention, right?
So you're getting paid to watch ads?
You're getting paid to watch ads. And what is the progress like? The roadmaps, right now they already have a browser up, and they already have stats on like how much faster things load because you have no more ads, and you know how much of your time you're saving and how much of your data is being saved. So if you want to go to Google up Brave browser, you'll see the statistics on there. Different ways to invest in cryptocurrency. So there's not just one way. You can go the most risky, which is go directly into the coins. A lot of people use Coinbase, right? Which is a really easy way to get in. They're a startup in San Francisco. You just connect your bank account, put money in, and transfer it for, so far they only have three coins in there, Litecoin, Bitcoin, and Ethereum. If you want to go to other exchanges, we can talk about that afterwards, or we can talk about that in a more advanced seminar. Medium risk, invest in a hedge fund. So they're starting to pop up these hedge funds, right? We're an early adopter almost, the other part of adoption, hedge funds are popping up and they are having different investments in there and different coins, right? And so you can put your trust in them, but as we can see from Warren Buffett's bet earlier, not all hedge funds are created equally, right? So do your research. I would rather take care of my own coins than trust an investment hedge fund, but up to what you want. Lower risk. Even lower is not even getting into the Bitcoin scene, but helping support the scene that is helping that scene, which is the processors and the graphics cards that are being used to mine those. So NVIDIA, AMD, and Intel, you can see that their stocks have been rising, and I think they say only 10% of it is from cryptocurrency, but you know that's better than not getting in at all. What's the sign-up process like for Coinbase? So you'll need your email, phone number, bank routing, account number. Someone was talking to me earlier about you only being limited to $1,000 to begin with. So there's a verification process. They ask you to take like a picture of your driver's license, front and back. So that's something to think of. You know, do I trust these guys? Will they lose my driver's license to anyone? You know, even the big people we trust, like Equifax before, it's like, it's hard to tell who has the best encryption these days, right? You go to Target, next thing you know, next month later, you say, oh, Target got hacked. What are we going to do? Well, the first thing I would do, at least, is grab a referral from your friend who's been telling you about cryptocurrency. You're saying your friend was telling you back since 2011? Go back to the guy. Be like, hey, man, sorry, I thought you were a flat earther, but I kind of want to jump in now. Let me give you $10. And let me give myself $10. Because once you get a referral, you get some extra money on top, right? You know? The way you fund the account, either through your checkings or savings, is at a different rate than if you were funding through a credit card or debit card. So take that in mind. If you want to finish your spend on your credit card for that trip to Hawaii, maybe it's worth it for you, maybe not. But think about that. Coinbase versus GDAX. So Coinbase and GDAX are actually the same place, kind of. But GDAX is less fees. You actually sign in to both sites with the same login information. The only thing with GDAX is it's not as friendly. It's not as mobile friendly as Coinbase. If you go download Coinbase, you can kind of look at it on your phone. There's no web app for that, or GDAX at least. But GDAX also gives less fees. Your fee is 0.25% rather than the 1.49. And actually, if you put in trades that are not immediately given through, like if you kind of want to, this is kind of like jumping into short-term trading kind of, but if you think like Ethereum is going to jump to a kind of crazy price that nobody's thinking about right now, you put that trade in, and it happens, then you don't get feed on that amount. Or if you sell at an amount where no one's buying, then you can also get that 0% fee too. How do I keep my coins safe? So from the least safe to the most safe, regular old password. So let's say you have a bunch of 25 Bitcoins in there. Right now, if you complete a blockchain, there's not a good chance that you would, but you only get 12.5, right? So they would rather use that computer power to like break your password and get in and steal your 25 Bitcoins. So something to think about. I've even heard of, there's verification process where you say, hey, send a code to my phone, and I'll enter that code in, and you'll know it's me because I'm the one that has my phone, right? There's actually been cases where they said, someone called the agency, had my information, and was able to transfer the phone number to another SIM, and then they were able to steal my account. So that's something to watch out for. Two-factor authentication is what I usually go for. I'm kind of looking more into these, but let's talk about that first. Two-factor authentication is phone apps like Authy or Google Authenticator, where they trust Google instead. They say, hey, Google, you give these 6-digit pins that change every 2 minutes or so. I trust this website with this. Can you please encode that so that whenever I want to try to sign in, I have to look at my phone to get that. But it's not a text, so that makes it different from the previous scenario. Or you can move your coins into a personal wallet. You have an address that you can just write on a piece of paper and a passcode on there as well, but you gotta watch out. If you lose that, there's no one that can tell you, hey, your wallet's this, isn't this. There's no support for you to come back to ask for help for. So, FireSafe Lock, maybe, if you want to go that route. Even safer is a hardware wallet, like Legend NOS or Trezor. Looks like, your question?
Yeah, how much do those like hardware wallets cost?
I think it's like $100. I think on Black Friday it was like 2 for $150.
Oh wow.
But
where can you buy those?
Trezor's on Amazon like $80.
Yeah, on Amazon. You might be worried about buying used ones, but I would say buy new ones just so they haven't tampered with it. Amazon.
Amazon should be eBay.
Yeah. yeah. So those are the ways you can keep your coins safe. Coins I own personally and why? Bitcoin, most used coin for buying alternative coins. Actually, buy Bitcoin so that I can use it to buy Bitcoins. It's the easiest way. Exchanges usually don't allow you to go from USD to other coins as easily. If there is there, then you need to actually go through a lot of verification processes. So I just buy my Bitcoins on Coinbase. I transfer it over to my other exchanges. I use that to buy other coins. Ethereum, again, programmable smart contracts. So those if-then statements being able to be programmable in any programming language is really helpful. So we talked about coins. There are also tokens which build off of coins that are using the Ethereum blockchain itself. So there are tokens out there. Ripple connecting banks for cross-border transactions. IOTA is, I think, a big contender for Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is on the blockchain, right, where you have one block and then it's in a linear form where it's blocked, blocked, blocked. Whereas the Tangle, it connects in multiple different ways, right? So there'd be what looks like a Tangle amount of blocks. So there's more ways of searching for your transaction by going through other ways, right? So that's something I think might be a contender to Bitcoin. Factum, reforming Japanese social security and land deeds database. Again, mainly blockchain is used for transactions, right? Can also be used for information, like keeping Social Security safe and keeping land deeds safe in their database. Numere, helping data scientists and AI come together to cater a hedge fund for your capital. That's something to look into. CA Coin, renting out your hard drive space, basic attention coin. Patiantori, decentralized patient data information storage. So when you go from Kaiser to your HMO or PO somewhere else, you don't have to move your file and say, hey, I'm Sarah Wright. Here's my data. Can you just put it into your system? Right. Easy information to access now. How do taxes work? So again, the highest standard to think of it is a property tax kind of way. Fiat to crypto, crypto to fiat, crypto to crypto are taxable events. And depending on your income level, then you'll be taxed. And let's check the Slido to see if there's any questions. Where is that? What's that? Cool. So just one question. How long have you been investing? We talked about this in the game, about a year or so. A year and a half, if you count that. Just kind of letting that lawnmower going passively, right? Yeah, so that's the only question there. If anybody has any other questions right now.
So when you sell your Bitcoin, then do they report it on a 1099? So that's how
as of right now, there is no 1099 that I know about. You kind of have to report it yourself.
Go back one slide.
That's all gonna change.
Well, I mean, we don't know what the actual
So this is just like keeping yourself safe, which is going at the higher standard, right? But once there's regulation that comes through, then we'll know for sure exactly how much it is.
So you mentioned Coinbase doing the top three, but some of the ones that we're buying were not in the top three. So what exchange are you using then?
I'm using Bittrex. I'm actually on like 10 other exchanges. Bittrex, Poloniex, Kraken, Binance. There's a few of them. If you want to go to a website called World Coin Index, that can, and you look up the coin that you're interested in, on the right side, it'll tell you which exchanges they're being currently being traded for and which currency they exchange for. Okay. Any other questions? Good. Okay. And I have one last question on the Slido, just for kicks to see how this goes. Let's see.
I have a question.
Yeah.
How did you prepare for this presentation? Like, how do you learn about Bitcoin stuff?
Just from what I've read in the last year. So like, I would like go home and I would read about these things into the night, and then you would see me, my housemate. She's like, "What are you doing up so late?" Just reading my paper.
What do you read? I guess, or like, where do you go for your information?
There's a blog called Zero Hedge that I really like. They do some tests sometimes. Mainly the subreddit cryptocurrencies is one that I really like, and then they always like kind of link their sources, and I'll go to there and learn more from there. That's a really good one to go to. And also, I ask my other friends that are investing currently, and I have friends that are like Bitcoin maximalists, where they think Bitcoin's only going to be the only coin in the future. Or I have active trader friends that are like, I'd rather actively trade and not lose all these gains and stuff like that. So there's different friends that I go to as well. Let's do one last question. If you guys can pull the Slido up on your phones, just want to take a quick poll. How likely are you to invest in cryptocurrency? And it's on a star rating system from 1 to 5. So,
that's so cool.
Seems like there's mainly interest in there. For the ones, twos, and threes, if there are any concerns or questions you have right now, this is, you know, I'm here for you. If you, even, you know, if you just want to call me up, you know, I can give you my phone number. I might be busy sometimes working on my company, but I'll try my best. But, just if there are any.
What's like the lowest fraction of a coin that you can purchase?
I think it depends on the exchange that you're on. Yeah, they have different.
It's like obviously I don't have, you know, $1,000 or $10,000 to buy a coin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry, I don't have that information off the top of my head. I can get back to you on that though. Question.
I actually, kind of in my interest of this talk, I made an account on Coinbase.
Nice.
And I put a trade through. There's a delay between when you want to buy Bitcoin and when you actually buy it.
Mm-hmm.
So I still haven't bought it yet.
Because you're waiting for your money to get in, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
I'll get it on the 5th, but I just bought like $10.
Oh, okay.
And the smallest increment that you can invest on Coinbase is $2.
Mm-hmm.
But they take a fee for that initial, for every transaction you make. It's like $1 or $1.50.
Mm-hmm.
So if you only buy $2 worth of Bitcoin, you're actually only buying $1 worth,
yeah.
And then they take the $1 fee.
So I would suggest maybe going on GDAX. It's almost the same. But instead of doing it on your phone, you can do it on a browser.
Right.
Less fees. Yeah.
Cool.
You had a question too?
Yeah, I was wondering what your opinion about Bittrex is.
On Bittrex?
Yeah.
Bittrex, I believe Bittrex is now weaning off of Americans. They're like breaking off from the US population. They're saying anyone that's on there.
There's Bitfinex.
Yeah.
There's no individual trading with US citizens now.
Mm-hmm. So you have to move your coins off. So those ones, unless you're thinking of moving to where they're located, then I wouldn't think about them too much. But if you have coins on there, I would move it out, because they're just gonna, I don't know if they're just gonna wipe your account, but that seems like what they, like whenever I sign in, they're like, hey, you should move your coins and stuff. So, yeah. 1, 2, 3s? No? No questions?
Oh. Do you participate in ICOs?
I do, but the ones that are really cool and really like futuristic, those get like funded real quick. Like Brave itself funded 30 million in 30 minutes.
Oh my god.
Not from the cash.
From cash. Yeah. Sometimes they also take Ethereum or Bitcoin too. So they'll send all that money.
Oh, by coin, have you heard of that? Cash with a Q?
Cash with a Q? No, I haven't. What is it about?
It's I guess it's they're trying to bring like liquidity into like, the cryptocurrency market, so I don't know, I guess their team's pretty stacked. I was doing some research on it, but yeah, look into it.
Yeah.
Text me about it.
QASH?
QASH.
QASH. Okay, yeah. I'll get it. We can talk about it in the middle of the night.
Yeah.
Any other questions? No? Okay, I think we're done.
Five-minute break so that you guys can stretch your legs and you know, talk to each other. And so what's going to happen after this is we're just going to talk about upcoming service projects. So if you have no interest in volunteering, that's okay. Just if you could spread the word, you know, that we exist. But yeah, we're going to take a five-minute break starting now. So it's 1:02. We'll restart at 1:07.
We hope everyone's interested in volunteering.
Oh, yeah. We want you all to be.
Liddy, can you mom's watching?
Oh, is she? Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh,
where's
the
eye?
Really?
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 Really? Really?
Really? Really?
Really? Really?
Really? Really? Really?
Really? Really? Really?
Really? Really? Really? Really? Really? Really?
Really? Really? Really? Really? Really?
Really? Really? Really? Really? Really?
Guess we got stuck behind the camera.
I do want to because
Saturday, I used my referral because my boss is
like,
oh,
did everybody
sign?
Okay, I'll ask
you for you.
I know two of the three viewers. Or do I?
Yeah.
Because I mean,
to be honest,
I
think
it's
not
your
thing.
Because
I mean,
oh, I know, right? I know, but we got the key to lunch. We're going to go to camp, right?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I'm on board at
I feel a little awkward.
I don't know who that is.
Mine.
I don't have a pen.
This is everywhere.
But you can alter it. It's a corporate member.
We're facing reefs on soldiers' graves in veteran cemeteries. So the one that I'll be out with my family, like family friends, but who wants to join, and I put the link on Facebook, on just the general POIP Facebook link, is the one in San Bruno. So I think you go out like 8 or 9 o'clock in the morning, and then all at the same time, fun little event.
Where is it?
San Bruno. It's the, so if you go on the link, I think it's the second link on the Facebook posting, you just search for a volunteer, just type in Golden Gate National Cemetery, that should be the San Bruno one, and then you can just like, and then you can just put your name in your register, and it gives you an email confirmation.
Is that the really, really big one? Like,
that's on the freeway.
Yeah, yeah. Just, like you see all of them.
Yeah, I've never been there before, so I have no idea.
Yeah.
But
yeah, you pass them to a year.
Yeah.
But
no one's interested in them, they're all going to hang around me, my friends and family. I don't want to be alone, but...
Which group sponsors it?
I don't know for sure. I have to look over again. I also placed, there are two links. The second one is should be to register, at least easier to register. The first one's like them talking about the organization that does it. So I think it's an annual thing.
Real quick, if you ever do decide to just go out and do service projects on your own, like not affiliated with us whatsoever, and you want credit for it, just submit your hours to this tiny URL right here, or just like email us, contact us, and we'll give you credit for it. And then Trung.
Oh, sorry.
Oh, yes.
What is that credit for?
So each Kiwanis Club is expected to fill out a monthly report form, and they like keeping track of all the service hours that the Kiwanis Clubs are doing, so you know, that sounds fancy. And what looks nice is when we submit more hours each month than the other Kiwanis Clubs in our area, people are really impressed with us, so that's why I like doing it. No, but then we just keep track of what people are doing, and then we could also see if we want to do more projects with that organization, if you're doing something really cool and we just don't know about it.
That's, I think, a good use of it.
But yeah, they like keeping track, because it's an international organization.
Trung, I think you had something that you wanted to talk about just now.
Okay. So, for those of you that have been with Kiwanis, there are multiple Kiwanis clubs sponsoring tree lots. Sounds like Kiwanis just asked me if there are any volunteers that would like to help out at the Sounds Like Kiwanis tree lot. Let's see. Their shifts today and tomorrow. Well, let's see, it's past 9 a.m. So 5 p.m. to 8:15, two people for today, and then they also need volunteers tomorrow. There are three different shifts starting at 9 a.m., 1 p.m., and 5 p.m. All proceeds from the tree lot go towards the SLP fund, which is the account that supports all of the Circle K's, the Key Clubs. So if you'd like to help out, let me know. I'll forward you the contact information to volunteer at the Sounds Like Kiwanis Tree Lot.
What's the location of that one?
That one is Camden and Union. Camden and Union? Wait, I don't have that address. Let me look that up real quick.
So if you're interested in helping with the tree lot, just let John know. Well, so City Team, this is an ongoing thing. So what City Team does is they help out the homeless people in the area to kind of integrate them back into society. So they provide them with food, shelter. If you want to help them out, these are the times that are available. You can help out in the kitchen or just doing basic volunteer work. Just send us an email if you're interested, and we'll connect you with the right people. You want Andrew to talk about? Hey, Andrew.
So this is the Disaster Response Volunteer Corps is a remote group of people who are outside disaster-stricken locations but want to help in digital ways. So the Disaster Response Volunteer Corps was a lot more active following the events of Harvey, Irma, and currently they're still active in supporting Puerto Rico. Basically, the things involved are a lot of coordination efforts, a little bit of data entry, and sometimes developing content to support awareness efforts or to highlight the needs of certain nonprofits and shelters on the ground. So that's all coordinated through this technology called Slack, and it's like just a messaging platform. So if you have any questions about that or want to get involved, talk to me. It's again, you kind of contribute however much time you can. It's very flexible, and it's a way for us in relatively safe areas compared to these disaster-stricken areas to contribute, even though we can't just uplift our lives and go volunteer. So yeah, talk to me.
Thank you, Andrew. And then we're still working with San Jose.
I think it's San Jose
and Campbell Quans Club, who work at the soccer stadium vending booths where the Earthquakes play. And there's various dates. It's pretty much all the soccer games, I believe. So I think the Saturday game and Sunday games is a little earlier in the day, right? But if you're interested in helping with that, they still need people to help at multiple different soccer games. And it's super easy. You're just taking people's money and giving them food.
It's literally work.
So if you want to do that, let us know. We can connect you with the right people to send you for that. The next event is Carol Weiss's tonight. We don't really need that many volunteers.
Yeah.
I think JR from the Campbell's Kiwanis Club is just having us be there just in case he needs help with something. It's mostly run by the Key Clubbers. Those are the high school branch of this organization, if you don't already know that. And there's Santa and some like snow that the kids can play in. Ice, just like ice block. just like piles of snow. and what else? There's like, I think treats and stuff for the kids.
They're like hand out.
And we've been like 6 years. Yeah, chocolate. Like cute things for kids to go to. Like, and it's an annual event in downtown Campbell. So if you want to go to that, I think a couple people are going to go just to be there. And you can probably just go sit down and eat dinner until you get called to duty.
Oh. Yeah, at this point, they have enough people. We're just on standby, so we're just going to go hang out and
just
eat
like
and drink.
Hang out
with
hours.
Oh, yeah. Do we get hours for that?
Yes,
we're on standby.
Next event, Los Altos Kiwanis Tree Lot. They are open every evening from 4 to 7. No, it's like 4 to 7-ish. So if you want to go out to Los Altos in the afternoon, they need help on the weekday. Or on the weekend, they're open from, I think, like 8:30 to 6:30. And they still need a ton of help with sales because their tree lot is actually super busy. I've been one day so far working the cash register. But most of the time, you're just like walking around with a clipboard, helping people pick out what size tree they want because, you know, they have all different size trees. And then selling the wreaths and the bows and all the extra little things that you get with your Christmas tree. And this is right near the Foothill Expressway exit on 28, so super close to the highway. But they really need help because their Kiwanis Club only like 10 members, and they're running this tree lot every single day until Christmas or the 16th or whatever.
Okay.
So, the great thing about this one is every hour we donate, they are donating $20 to organization of our choice. So we can decide later. For right now, we have $80. So,
yay.
But that's better than nothing.
Cool.
So. Let me know if you want to do this, and I can send your information to the person in charge from Los Altos Kiwanis. Upcoming DCMs, if anybody wants to go to a division council meeting where all of the Division 34 clubs meet, and there's free dinner. It's 7 to 8:30 usually, and dinner starts at 6:30, but there's things, different locations each time. So if anybody's available on a Wednesday evening, there's free food. They're interesting. You get to learn what the other Kiwanis clubs are doing. But if anybody can go to these, or is close to like South San Francisco, that'd be awesome. Because I can't get up there. So we try to get someone to represent our club at least. But just let me know. And then upcoming meetings. We have a board meeting online. New, and if you're not on the board, you're welcome to join us to talk about various things that we're doing in the future, and where we want to see the club going over the next year.
Right? Yeah, so it really is open to everyone and super convenient. You just like, you need a computer, or not even, like a lot of the time you guys just like dial in and we're like, yeah, that's fine. So you just give us your input, tell us what you want from the club, what your expectations are, and we do our best to make it happen. You want to talk about the general meeting?
And then on January 6th, we're having another general meeting like this one. It's always the first Saturday of every month at 12 p.m. Here. And then, do you know who's speaking?
Oh, I thought you said Pat was speaking.
We're going to figure out who the guest speaker is, but we will have a seminar on that day, well, every meeting, but TBA.
Yeah, we'll send you guys all invites.
Oh, and then this is not, we hasn't finalized yet, but I did send in our paperwork.
Yes.
So we are adopting this car, right?
It's really close.
Orange piece of highway, the northbound side. Mm. I don't know how dirty it is. We're going to be cleaning it up because I don't drive over there. But
six eighty
northbound, right before Milpitas, pretty much near here. So we're adjusting the paperwork to adopt this, and it seems like it should be a pretty easy process. They're just making me mail in the adoption form, it's because they need like a wet signature, whatever. So we'll probably have it in like a month or two. But it's completely free to adopt to highway, which is cool. So you get your name on one of those little side. Highway science is awesome, and we just kind of need to talk about
when you're
interested in cleaning up the side of the highway. So it's like Saturday in January. Saturday morning, is that preferred?
Well, if you guys just if you send an email to us, be like, hey, I'm always free Saturdays at 2 p.m. We'll start doing things Saturday at 2 p.m. So if nobody says anything, we'll just go by.
But we don't want to do it too early where people are still sleeping into the party in the day before or whatever.
Nothing
I don't know what you guys do.
Nothing wakes you up like cars zooming right past you.
But we will get trained on how to effectively pick up trash, I guess, on the side of the highway. That's what I was saying. And you have to wear your safety vest thing.
Yeah.
Hat. Okay. Yeah, have you done it?
Yeah.
Oh. Okay.
I still have all the stuff.
Awesome.
So Sarah's gonna train us.
Just stay off the freeway.
But this is gonna be our focus. Since you have to do that once a month, so we're hoping to find a project that's just our club. Because most of our other projects we do with other Kiwanis clubs, we just kind of tag along. But so this is gonna be our thing for now until we find something cool.
Are we good?
We're not giving up on it.
Are we just adopting it and making sure it's beautiful, or are we actually gonna get a little sign that's
you get the sign,
or we get the sign.
Yeah. If you want to pay extra, it can be color, but it's the free ones, just black and white sign. I think that's what the guy said.
Yeah,
I don't know.
Can we plant stuff?
I don't know if we're allowed to plant stuff, but that's something we can check in on.
Hell yeah.
We got watermelons.
What sticks in carbon?
Avocados. Yeah, California.
What sucks in the most
carbon outside there?
Aloe vera.
All right, I'll ask you to
create
more waste. All the protocol.
Anybody else have any questions about this?
I was free to adopt the highway.
Yeah,
I think we have to commit 2 years, but that's not a big deal.
Two talking about years.
Oh. No, 2 years.
We're
there every month, I think.
Oh, every month?
Yeah.
I thought you said
it was
once every quarter or something like that.
No,
once a month. Once a month. But hopefully after the first time, it won't be as hard the next time.
Okay.
So we are just checking, I guess they are just checking trash out.
How many highways do you want?
No. I'm saying the second time,
hopefully
it's not dirty.
Oh, I see. Okay.
We're going all the way up the Fremont. All the way up the Fremont.
The entire thing.
This is dirty.
This is all ours.
This is us.
I see the names there.
Alright.
Sign after sign of ours. Is there more?
Potluck.
Okay, so this Friday at my apartment, we're having a potluck / board game night / white elephant. And we're awesome.
Yeah, we are.
So if you're interested in joining, just let me know. I know we have about 8 people coming on the Facebook group or event, so I can give you my address.
Wait, there's a Facebook event?
Yeah. Yeah, so you
I just got the Google invite.
Please say yes so I know how many people back, because I'm getting chairs from my parents' house and a table. So if I need 2 tables, I need to know. So just let me know. And then we have a sign up sheet for the food. A couple people have already signed up, thank you. But we obviously need more food items. So I'll send that link out again to sign up for food. And then BYOB, because alcohol is expensive, so bring your own.
And hopefully everyone's okay with the dog. Does anyone have a dog in that part? That is pretty much it.
Quick thing. So I know that Facebook thing, PYP Kiwanis, that's actually our Facebook page. You should like it. But we also have a Facebook group, so if you're more accustomed to getting notifications on Facebook, you can contact Judy. Her number is on your agenda. And then after you friend her, you can join our Facebook group.
Yeah, that's where more of like the personal stuff is. Like, where I'll put my address to go to the event.
Yeah. So we're keeping this a little low-key, so we haven't like really pushed the potluck too much.
Yeah. So. Yeah, we're not really inviting like other Kiwanis clubs, so they don't want like a million people show around from it. So.
I'll bring my dad, it'll be super awkward.
Okay. And the last.
Do you have happy side turn?
Yeah. So for everyone who hasn't been here before, this is like a kind of traditional Kiwanis thing to kind of just raise a little bit of funds. You don't have to participate, and you don't have to donate any money. But we have a happy sad jar. We do it through Venmo, so we don't actually have a jar. But you can still give cash if you're interested. But you kind of just say something you're really happy about over the last month, or something you're sad about over the last month. And then you can donate however much money you feel is just to help our club with their, you know, our administrative costs.
They also do cash.
Yeah, cash or Venmo. Venmo is PYP Kiwanis, super easy.
It has an image now. It's not the silhouette.
All right. Andrew, do you want to start?
Yeah. Cool. Hi, I'm Andrew.
Hi, Andrew.
Hi. I have one happy dollar and one sad dollar, so I'm a bit annoying right now. I'll start with the happy news. As of last Friday, I finished a programming boot camp in San Francisco in July, and I've been job searching ever since. So this past Friday, I just signed and accepted a role for a business data analyst at a climate change analytics and consulting firm.
Nice.
So my start date is 12/11, so this the 11th coming up, and that's exciting. You can just chill for a little while, but I'm really happy. And but the sad part is it's gonna bring me to downtown Berkeley, so I won't be here as often during the work week, but I plan to visit on the weekends. But another reason why I'm throwing in the sad dollar is because on the day of the potluck, 12/8, my soon-to-be manager asked me to team with him in a hackathon that weekend. So I'm going to be doing a hackathon prior to my start date, just for fun. But I won't be able to make the potluck, so have fun for me. get turned.
With board games. Oh yeah, bring your own board games. I'm crossing
too. BYOBG.
And Beowulf.
Yeah, I'm gonna hold it now.
Okay.
Ooh.
I don't know yet.
What?
In this day
here.
Age.
Treasure. You get a cup.
introduce yourself.
Okay.
Sorry. I like standing. Hi, my name is Miles. If you guys don't already know me, I used to be part of Mission College CKI. So, actually, it's just gonna be happy. I'm happy that No Shave November is over. So, oh my gosh, it was hard being in a hotel front desk and people just like, oh man, you're just really growing now. The reason why it's happy though, I did it for my friend who got diagnosed with early stage breast cancer. She was my age as well, but the reason why it's happy, I did No Shave November for her because it's supposed to be about cancer awareness, not just so you don't have to shave. She just got back her mammogram test and she's clear right now.
I will donate a happy dollar, or two happy dollars. The first one, I'll do Venmo, don't worry. yesterday was my work Christmas party, and the principal at the school gave us all $300 in cash. Awesome! A bonus. So, it was awesome. And then, I'm also super happy that everyone's here, because we have way more people than normal. And if you're interested in officially joining after this meeting, there's a middle piece in these pamphlets
that is asking for your information so I can put your information into Kiwanis International, and you can become an official member. Yay!
And where can they find these pamphlets?
I gave one to each person.
Oh, okay. All right.
They're also on the table.
Yeah, they're also on the front. And don't worry about dues for now. If you are a past Circle K or Key Club member and you have never been in a Kiwanis Club before, your dues are free for 2 years, so that's awesome. Or since we have enough administrative money right now, we are just asking for like a $50 deposit. And then if you come to 2 service projects and 2 meetings at least, we are willing to give you back your $50, or you can just donate it to the club. Super easy. So if you're interested, just fill out this sheet. Thank you so much for coming.
Oh, I'll go on. I'm happy that the seminar went well. A lot of people were saying that they learned a lot, so that's what I like the seminars for. Kind of sad, because we went canvassing this week for the app we're making, and a council member treated us very badly for what we're trying to do. What we're trying to do is we're trying to allow residents to rent out their driveways to people who need it. Mm-hmm. So like, for instance, college students or people going to stadiums or airports. And got a lot of flack of that for that from the homeowner association. So we're working on that. So that's fine.
It's the HOA.
Haters
gonna hate you.
Yeah.
Was it San Jose?
It was in San Jose. Yeah.
Which district was it?
Santa Clara.
Oh. So not San Jose.
Oh, I guess it's Santa Clara. It's next to Levi's Stadium.
Oh, I mean, yeah. That's usually difficult though because they're always worried about if you can ensure safety.
And zoning.
So
we have an insider, and they're like, yeah, they're saying, what if people fall?
Right.
I'm like,
that's the thing.
People fall in their TV.
Exactly.
So we kind of need to figure that out.
But there's a lot of liability. It's like,
right.
People.
Which is good, a good thing, right? So we can learn about it. So
yeah.
I guess that's happy.
Yeah.
We got info.
I have happy dollar and I have silver dollar. Thank you. I am happy that I was invited here. And I'm just sad that there's not more people here.
Yeah. I'm happy because I just had a wrap party for my first web series shoot that I worked on. It was a comedy, and it was directed and written by this Asian American girl who was in a class that I attended, and she made this thing, and it was over like 5 days, and then she's about to. She gave it to Sundance, and I think like they showed it there, and there's a bunch of other things that they're gonna do, but it looks really good, and I'm happy because I was a PA, but then I got upgraded to like a wardrobe person, so at least I have that on my resume. And then now I've been a PA on like 2 other advertising shoots like after that, so it's good.
Anybody else?
Dollar. Because yesterday I submitted my first what they call like abstract, which is like a summary of a presentation I want to do at a psychology conference yesterday. Mm-hmm. So hopefully we get accepted and so I can present that thing of research next August. And I got really good feedback from my supervisors on it. They really liked the work that I did and the corrections that I made, so that was really validating.
Yay. Nice.
Thank you.
Oh, Sarah.
I'm gonna give a happy dollar because it's Christmas time. And I like Christmas.
Yeah, that's a pretty good reason. Yeah. Anybody else out there?
I'm putting in a sad dollar that I just earned at work. I got called at 7 a.m. Because something was wrong with the electronic health record system, so that was kind of important, and which is also why I was late to the meeting.
Okay.
And unfortunately, I mean, thankfully the issue was resolved, but you know, it's supposed to be my day off. I was also in the middle of playing Diablo 3. But I got interrupted for work, but now I'm here, and yeah.
Good job.
Thanks for coming back.
Alright. Anybody else?
Or no shaky bed.
It's like, I'm basically, oh, I'm sorry, guys. all right, I guess I'll go ahead and end it with my happy dollar that I will Venmo. I'm just really glad that you guys came out today. This is, I want to say, our biggest meeting so far. Yeah, so, yes, thank you, everyone.
Yeah.
Yay! Woo! I'm going to, all right, so, you guys are probably all starving by now. We're going to... Yeah, so we're going to grab lunch after this. We haven't decided where yet, but if you stick around, we'll figure it out. Afterwards, we're going to go to downtown Campbell at 3:30 p.m. for Carol of Lights. Again, you guys are more than welcome to join us. And that's it. Meeting adjourned. Thank you, everyone.
Goodbye.
Oh, yeah. Everyone goodbye. Wave goodbye.
Bye, Ben.
Oh, wow.
He's still watching.